Hearing officer, and I call the meeting of Wednesday, August 17th to order. Today we have four items on our agenda, and I haven't received any requests for continuances or withdrawals, so we'll hear them in the order that they appear on the agenda. Under announcements and appeals, I'd like to announce that we have received one appeal. It was for 2912 De La Vina Street, and it was heard by the SHO on July 20th, and at that date, the SHO partially approved a front setback modification. And the applicant has appealed it to the Planning Commission, and a date for the Planning Commission has been set, and that's for September 8th. So if you are following that project, it's on the Planning Commission agenda on the 8th. And I have no other announcements and appeals. Is there anyone in the audience who would like to address the staff hearing officer on items not on today's agenda? No? Seeing no one, we'll go to the first item, which is 1028 Olive Street, if the applicant would like to come up and sit in the chairs. Good morning. Once they sit down, anytime you're ready, good sir.
Thank you.
Sit down,
baby.
So, good morning, members of the public and Ms. Reardon. We're here for a project at 1028 Olive Street. The project proposes a new residential on the residential unit at the back of the property. To put in or construct a new residential unit, the applicant proposes to demolish the existing garage near the back of the property and build a new one-story, one-bedroom, 750-square-foot residential unit. It would also be attached by a new three-car carport that would attach both the new unit and the existing unit, creating a duplex. The project also proposes to remove some existing paving at the front of the property in an area that was currently used for parking that was unpermitted. So the project proposes to remove the paving in this area and install landscaping, including permeable pavers.
That was permitted. We had a permit for the...
Unpermitted for parking, I think is what she meant. The parking part of it.
One thing regarding that, the existing dwelling was built in 1929 and was reviewed by the city's historian, and because it is eligible on the city's historic potentials list, she did not support the use of this area for parking. So that's part of the rationale for having both of the parking provided in the back of the unit with a three-car carport instead of having a fourth space up here. Per the ordinance standards, the additional unit would have required two new parking spaces, and then two would have been required for the existing three-bedroom single-family unit. So the applicant's requesting a reduction by one space to provide only three spaces at the back of the unit. The Transportation Division reviewed the project, and they believe that as a 750-square-foot dwelling with only one bedroom, one space would be sufficient. Therefore, the parking needs for the property would be met by the three-car carport. And that, in addition to that, staff reviewed the project for environmental impacts under CEQA and looked at the archaeological resources. We included a condition of approval that covers any archaeological discovery, unintentional discovery during construction. Aside from that, the project, there are no anticipated environmental impacts, and the project was found to be exempt under CEQA. Staff recommends approval of the parking modification, and we're here for any questions.
Okay, great. Thanks. Mm-hmm. I don't have any questions right now. Would you like to state your name for the record and provide
a... My name is Tony Zcase, the designer. This is Frank Ortega, the son of the owner, Adelaide Ortega.
Okay, would you like to add any?
I would. There's part of the transportation requirements that we're asked to provide was some bicycle parking or storage. So we've done that in the back of this unit in lieu of that last parking space that's kind of paid off that they asked us to provide. There's some bicycle storage for future use. My owner doesn't really ride a bicycle, but future owner maybe. But that was kind of a little trade-off that transportation has to provide.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Then, in addition, in regards to since you're talking about transportation stuff, I assume this here is 10 feet by 10 feet. This area. It's not proposed for another parking space.
No, it's
in the setback. Okay, has transportation reviewed it? Is this total area necessary? My concern is since it is in the setback and a setback modification wasn't requested.
Yeah, that's well, we worked it out so all these spaces have enough turnaround or backup distance and maneuvering distance. So we did need that depth. Not so much for this one, but it's actually this one that's a little difficult to get out. And you know, and go forward from there. So so they're okay with that the parking design or maneuvering design, I should say.
Okay. All right, those are my questions for right now. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anybody here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on 1028 Olive Street? Seeing no one, I did like to note that I received a letter from a neighbor expressing concerns with the parking modification. And had you received it? Do you have that?
No.
Do you have extra copies?
I have a copy if you need it.
You have a copy. So you've received one, Tony?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If she wants to review.
Well, he's actually on Figueroa Street, so I'm not sure that he's impacted so much. It's kind of a parking issue.
Okay, so I'll close the public hearing. Or is there any more? Did we receive any other letters on this particular one?
Ms. Reardon, I did receive one phone call from a neighbor, and they just wanted details on the project, and they were not opposed.
Okay, so just more informational gathering?
Yep.
Okay, great. I'll close the public hearing. I did go out to the site to review the neighborhood, and even on a non-school day, you know, there is a lot of parking on the street. But I agree with transportation staff in regards to that it's meeting its demand on site.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually improving the situation in that there's just the one car garage right now that they're demolishing, and they're adding two more, so to meet the demand of the existing unit as well as providing the one additional unit. My concern is, though, since this area here is within the setback and there's been no request for a modification, if I were to approve the project, I would put a condition on the project that transportation staff reviews this and has it be the minimum necessary to provide maneuverability,
okay.
Because
mm-hmm.
it would be crazy to require you to back out and all the way down the driveway.
Yeah.
So it is really important for you to have your maneuverability in this area to back up so you can head out
right.
Face first.
Mm-hmm.
I would add that condition. Also, another condition I would add is, given that transportation staff has said that the new unit, given its size of 750 square feet and one bedroom, meets the demand, I will put a condition on the project that the new unit not exceed 750 square feet nor have more than one bedroom,
okay.
So that we can ensure that it continues to meet its demand.
Okay.
And then in regards to the paving in the front yard, the existing paving, your proposal here is really going to be an improvement to the neighborhood. One concern I would have is that, well, there's two concerns. One, the zoning ordinance doesn't allow parking within the front setback, which is in this area. And then if it's in the remaining front yard, it needs to be screened from the street. So the way it is right now, you're not proposing it. And then the other concern would be the urban historian's concern regarding the potential effects of having parking in the front area, front yard on the building. I want to put a condition that if the project's revised to keep that paving, which I agree it is permitted, I saw those records, and that some physical barrier be between the driveway and if this paving were to remove a physical barrier to prevent parking in that area.
Okay.
So it's not, my condition would not prohibit it from remaining, although I encourage you to implement this part of the plan. Mm-hmm. What it would do is make a physical barrier to prevent the parking.
Like a low wall or something?
Yeah, something so the cars just can't. And other than just pots, because you remove those pots and stuff, it needs to be some kind of physical filtering barrier.
Okay.
So, I just wanted something simple in the front, like right now it's so easy to keep clean, you know, and I just don't want to do a lot of gardening anymore.
Oh, yeah. Well, that then my condition would not prohibit it to be still paving.
Yeah, just a barrier from the driveway.
Yeah, but I think this really enhances your property with the improvements in the front, with the walkways to the driveway, to the porch and that kind of stuff. So with those three added conditions and the condition that staff was already proposing regarding the archaeological, what's it called? Yeah, the remote possibility of discovering archaeological resources. I can make the findings outlined in the staff report, including the environmental review finding. My action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days, and they also have oversight authority of all my actions, and if they felt that warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same 10-day review period, and if either of those would occur, Megan would contact you.
Okay.
Okay?
Great.
Thanks.
Thank you.
We'll go to the next item, which is 100 East Constance Avenue. Anytime you're ready, Joanne.
Okay. Property is address is 100 East Constance Avenue. The property is zoned E1. It's a 37,779 square foot lot. Current development on site consists of a single-family dwelling, a pool, a garage, an attached garage, and a detached as-built shed. The proposed project includes first and second-story additions to the dwelling and permitting the as-built shed. There's a designated historic tree at the property that's to remain unaltered in its location over here. A little background, in 1997, a modification was approved to allow a carport in this location, which encroached into the required front and interior setbacks. And in 2014, a zoning information report identified that the carport had been converted to a shed without the permits. This original project was approved by the Single Family Design Board, and it included for the additions, but it included removal of the shed, and a building permit was issued for that project. However, at this point, the project has been revised to include the as-built, permitting the as-built shed. The requests before you today are front setback modification to allow the as-built shed and the required 30-foot front setback facing Constance Avenue, a interior setback mod to allow the as-built shed and the interior setback along this property line, 10-foot required interior setback, and a modification to allow the shed to be located within a front yard. So a small corner of this shed encroaches into the required 30-foot front setback facing Constance Avenue. And also it should be noted that this property is located at a corner and has two front setbacks on Anacapa and Constance Avenue. So a small portion of the shed encroaches into the setback in the front. Staff supports that modification because the encroachment is minor. The property is constrained due to the two front yards. And the shed is not visible from the street. And it will not encroach further than the prior approved structure in that location, which was a carport at that time. The second setback is an interior setback modification to allow the door on the shed and a door in this location for the shed to encroach into the interior setback. Staff supports the interior setback modification because the grade change, there's a grade change along this property line, and actually this is much lower, the grade for this, than the adjacent property's grade is higher. So also, the shed will not encroach any further into that setback than that previously existed, and the structure will provide a needed storage for the property, for various equipment to maintain for maintenance and
yard.
Yeah, and it's not anticipated to adversely impact the adjacent neighbor. It's been there for a while, and it doesn't seem to be a problem. And in regards to the accessory space in the front yard, the zoning ordinance does not allow accessory buildings except for garages to be located in the front yard. Therefore, a modification is required. Staff supports the requested modification because the proposal will allow the as-built shed in the front yard, and it's not anticipated to adversely impact the street frontage or the adjacent neighbors, and it's not visible from the street. The project was reviewed by the Single Family Design Board and was forwarded to the staff hearing officer with comments. Staff would like the proposal approved and supported subject to the findings and conditions contained in the staff report. And the condition at this point was for the violations to be abated and included in the scope of work for the project. And that concludes staff presentation. We did receive one letter regarding the project in support, and that's been forwarded to you as well as to the applicant.
Okay. So in terms of the front yard for this property, since it's on a corner and it's a weird shaped building, the front yard is really like here to here, right? So like the majority of the property is the front yard. Wow.
So this is primary front setback.
Yeah, no, I'm meaning what the definition of front yard.
Yes.
This is their front.
That's the required.
This is the entry door. Mm-hmm.
I know, but per the zoning ordinance, you have the front setback and then front yard. So like in terms of location of the accessory building, it's really limited of where it is. Okay, that was just a comment. All right.
And see, too, that Constance and the neighbor who wrote the nice letter, she lives here. Mm-hmm. That's her house. The floor level is about 15 feet down from the street.
Okay.
And
you
then
like
the hedges are high.
Can you state your name for the record first?
Diana Kelly from Becker Studios.
Okay. And so, okay.
And so nobody sees this. I would hope you got a chance to walk in there, and you still can. And here it is to resemble the garage.
Let's put it so people
so it looks more
see.
Like a garage, but only a smart car could really fit in there. Mm-hmm. It's not deep enough for a real car.
Yeah, that was one of the questions.
It's always been a shed there, though.
Yeah, when I went to the site, I was able to get on the site, and both doors were open, so I was able to see inside. Because that was one of my questions: why did you officially want to change it to a shed instead of a garage? Car wouldn't fit in there
because of this wall.
Mm-hmm.
It's just even straight away, we'd be. There's just no way.
Yeah, I was trying to visualize when it was a carport, how a car really fit in there.
Looking in the file back to 1929, they've always had some sort of garden shed there.
Something.
You know, a detached thing without that trellis. Mm-hmm. And there's no other place for this owner to put their gardening things anywhere. And you can see, having visited, there's all these, you know, house materials and things. And that's, we need the door to be able to make it nice and clean like that. Mm-hmm. So that's the goal, is to maintain what's been there for probably 30 years, because it was closed up probably 20 years when they put the doors on and the walls mm-hmm. to that carport. So okay. We were allowed to move forward by saying it should be demolished through the process to be able to do our work here and get our clients living here. So now we're going to try and wrap up the job.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Great. Thanks. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on 100 East Constance? Like you said, I did receive the one letter and read it from the neighbor. And there was no additional ones attached to the staff report. Have we received any other comments?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll close the public hearing. Like I said, I did go out to the site. It's a very beautiful property.
Yes.
And
Carlton Winslow, 1930.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That was our goal, was to take back some of the things that have been done through the decades, mm-hmm. take it back to a more historic look.
Mm-hmm. Oh, good.
Yeah.
I don't think historic resources were noted on this, but it's
no,
just
we're all
the,
good. We've yeah. been through it. I mean, this has been reviewed for 2 years now,
right?
Through design review mm-hmm. and through the historic process, and
okay.
everything's dialed in.
Mm-hmm. Well, in regards to the modification with the change of use in the setback, it is appropriate improvement for that setback area. The a shed would probably even be less intense than a garage or a carport. It's more enclosed. I did notice that there was a door back here, but as you said, there's the grade change, and so
I have floor plans to show the building. There you go.
Yeah, so then there's the...
This is where they park their two cars, so mm-hmm. they do have that accomplished.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it provides an extra storage area, not in the garage, so
exactly.
they can use their garage for storage.
Yes, this is deep enough to have a little bit back there, but they really need to have that
mm-hmm.
purely for storage.
Okay.
And for all their use all their gardens then, they have a lot of landscaping things they need to mm-hmm. put in there.
Okay. So in regards to the change of use from the carport to the shed, it is an appropriate improvement consistent with all the earlier approvals for the carport. And same thing with the front setback modification. It's just a small corner. It
yeah.
doesn't change the streetscape any. It's just
take
the, just
across,
the nick.
Yep. And the
and
door then hits right in there.
Mm-hmm. So I
so
can
that's
make...
that's two.
Yeah. Well, let me finish talking. So in regards to the requested modifications, I can make the finding for the front setback modification as well as the interior setback modification. And then in regards to the detached accessory space, there's very limited space on where it could occur on the site. And in its current location, it is screened from the street and you know, it's adjacent to the garage. It provides a nice elevation for the front of the garage with the door, or for the front of the building with the door. So I can make the findings in regards to the detached accessory space also. As Joanne said, she was proposing a condition to abate the violations, and based on my site visit and review of the plans, I don't believe I need to add any additional conditions to the project. So therefore, I make the findings as outlined in the staff report and approve your project subject to that condition of approval. And my action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days, and they also have oversight authority of all my actions. And if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same 10-day review period. And if either of those would occur, Joanne would contact you.
Okay, great. Okay? Thank you very much.
Uh-huh. So we'll go to the next item, which is 246 San Clemente.
You have these. Those
yeah.
are yours.
This is 246 San Clemente. The property is zoned E3, and it's a 6,098 square foot lot. The current development on site consists of an 1,820 square foot single family residence, an attached garage of 256 square feet, and it's a one car garage and a shed. The proposed project involves 288 square feet of first floor addition and 169 square foot second story addition to the dwelling and removal of the shed. The proposed total is 94% of the maximum required floor to lot area ratio. The property is located in the non-appealable jurisdiction of the coastal zone and requires coastal review. The request before you today is a parking modification to allow one covered parking space instead of the two covered spaces required by ordinance. The property is currently non-conforming to parking with one covered parking space in a garage. The zoning ordinance states that if the additions to the dwelling exceed 50% of the net floor area, and that is a cumulative total as of July 15, 1980, then the project has to be brought up to current parking, which is two covered parking spaces in a garage. The findings to grant a parking modification are that the modification would not be inconsistent with the purposes and intent of the zoning ordinance, and that it would not cause an increase in the demand for parking or loading spaces in the immediate area. Transportation staff has stated that the parking demand for a single family residence is not dependent on the size of the dwelling, but only the residential use itself, and that the parking demand for a single family residence is two parking spaces. Transportation staff finds the demand for the existing house is two spaces, and the parking demand for the enlarged house would also be two spaces, but the project would not cause an increase for the demand in parking in the immediate area. Our planning staff believes that the purpose and intent of the zoning ordinance is to provide adequate parking for various uses. In the case of a single family residence of the proposed size, staff believes two parking spaces are adequate and that the ordinance allowance for up to 50% additions without requiring additional parking is a fair way to allow increases before requiring parking to be brought up to current code. Therefore, planning staff does not support the request to allow one covered parking space because the modification is not consistent with the purposes and intent of the zoning ordinance to provide adequate parking. The project was reviewed by the Single Family Design Board and was forwarded to the staff hearing officer with comments. And also, a letter of support was received for the project, and I believe it was included in your packet.
Yeah, there's two, actually. Okay.
That concludes staff presentation.
Okay, great, thank you. Yeah, there's just two, Bob and Sharon Callis, mm-hmm. and Robbie and Jennifer Church.
Okay.
And I have, did you get this one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'll see that.
Perfect, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, great, thank you. Would you like to state your name for the record and provide additional comments?
Sure, I'm Jarrett Gorin from Vanguard Planning, and
Jeremy Jewell, owner.
He's the homeowner. Well, I'll start off by saying we disagree with staff's recommendation. I'll get into that in a minute. But I'd like to just walk you through the project really quick to see what we're doing and also talk about what Single Family Design Board looked at and said. I'm really looking at the floor plans is what we need to do. Well, actually, let's start with the site plan. So the original house that was built on this lot was pretty much this house right here. And
so that, what was the size of the original house?
The original house was probably only around 1,000 square feet or so.
I think it was 1,200.
Yeah, it was a really small house. And it established this configuration on the lot. The garage is in the original location, and this is where the house was placed on the lot. And when I first started working on this project, one of the things I always look at when an applicant comes to me with a modification is there some way that you could comply? Is there a way that you actually could meet the parking requirement or do a new garage or reconfigure something that works? And in this case, there really isn't. I mean, it's possible that, you know, maybe you could demolish this garage and build a new two-car garage somewhere in the back, but then we'd be asking for a different modification that would eliminate the open yard area on this site and would be a lot more development and a whole big driveway and more grading and, you know, cars going by the neighbors. It didn't seem to trade one mod for another mod made a whole lot of sense in this case. And because of where the house is placed, leaving the garage where it is and trying to get into the back isn't possible because there just isn't enough space between the house and the property line to get a compliant 8-foot minimum width driveway. So the original house construction sort of established a pattern of development on this lot, and it included the one-car garage because that's just what they built at that time. And it was a very small house as well. So sometime in the early 80s, they did this addition on the back of the house, which was part of this aggregate square footage that's getting us up to the 50%. And they also did an addition of that created the second story that's on this house. It's an existing two-story house now. So it started off as a very small house, and that'll play into what I'm going to talk about in just a minute. So all that the homeowner wants to do here is it's a fairly small addition to the existing house. And it's really just to, you know, improve sort of a functionally obsolete floor plan and bring it up to a more modern floor plan within the existing footprint of the house and, you know, very minor changes to the exterior. So just sort of, and it doesn't involve the addition of any new bedrooms or bathrooms. That's also critical. It's not really increasing the intensity of the use on the site. They're just sort of expanding their kitchen to be a larger modern kitchen for their growing family. And then upstairs in the master bedroom, to right now the bathroom and everything's sort of over here, and this is the edge of the house, and they're just gonna, it's basically adding a functional larger closet and a modern bathroom upstairs and slightly increasing the size of their master bedroom. So not really changing the scope of uses on the site at all. It's just a slight increase of the house and entirely consistent with setbacks, height requirements, everything else. Single Family Design Board reviewed the changes, determined that they were aesthetically appropriate. They did specifically acknowledge the constraints on the site and the difficulty of providing any additional parking space. Essentially, you'd have to demolish and rebuild this house or a large portion of this house to comply with that requirement. Now, the fact that this does not generate any increased demand for parking, that's sort of, we all agree about that. So the other half of that finding is it consistent with the purpose and intent of the municipal code? And staff's position is that, well, because this requires a modification and exceeds that 50%, that it's not. And we disagree with that. That's a standard in the municipal code, and there are many other standards in the municipal code, like setbacks or parking ratios or the number of spaces required for a new residential unit. And all of those can be modified by the city and are regularly. Just this morning.
Well, they're modified because they meet the purposes and intent of the zoning ordinance, and they meet demand.
Right. So I'm gonna expand on that.
The first project's not germane to this.
Oh, I understand.
Okay.
But what I'm saying is that 50% trigger is one standard in the municipal code, and it's modifiable just like
Correct.
Any other standard in the municipal code.
You need to make the findings to modify it.
And you need to make the findings to do it. So the fact that this exceeds that standard in and of itself doesn't mean it's inconsistent with the municipal code.
Correct.
The same way that if something encroaches in a setback in and of itself doesn't mean it's inconsistent. It's up to you to determine whether you believe it's consistent with the purpose and intent. So in this case, and we understand staff's discussion about how the 50% is supposed to allow for reasonable expansions, but the problem with that is that when you start with something that's extremely small, your 50% is much different than the 50% of somebody that maybe started off with something bigger than you are. And if the end result is still entirely consistent, which this is, we believe that even if it exceeds that 50%, it could still be consistent as long as the remaining result remains consistent. And we are under what we would be allowed to expand this house to under any other conditions. So really, it's a unique configuration on this site, and it's constraints on this site that were established by the original configuration of the house, and a very low 50% trigger also established by the original configuration of this house, which is triggering the need for this modification. So, you know, really, we think the most critical thing is meeting the demand, which we still meet according to transportation and our own private consultant.
You don't increase the demand.
We're not increasing it. We don't meet it because we're non-conforming, but we're not making it more non-conforming as to demand. So we disagree that this is inconsistent with the purposes and intent of the zoning ordinance. We can understand why staff would maybe not just by default recommend approval in a case like this. It deserves scrutiny, obviously. I think that the intent of the zoning ordinance is to allow up to 50% without that additional scrutiny, and then above 50% to require it. So this obviously requires it, and that's what we're here for, and it's to get this specific review in this case.
Okay. I have two things. One, in response to the unfairness of our requirement, we are actually looking at that in our ENZO and proposing some changes to that. And so I would recommend that you go to the joint meeting on the 29th of this month, because they're specifically talking about parking, not only in the residential setting, but also in the commercial setting. So that's that. But I'm under the restrictions of the current ordinance. So in your opinion, then, in the single family setting, when the demand for parking for units over 750 square feet is 2, and in this situation, when would it not be appropriate to grant the mod? When it's based on the use, not on the, when we have this, we allow, the zoning ordinance allows for a reasonable expansion of these non-conforming uses, 50%. And you're right, in the smaller instances, you know, we have 900 square foot houses that want to do 900 square foot more, make it, you know, 1,800, which is on the small size in Santa Barbara. They can't without the modification or, you know, showing they do demand. So in your instance, when would it not be appropriate to grant a modification in the single family setting?
I can answer that. I think above 50%, it triggers scrutiny and the require for a modification request. And I think in that case, the city has the ability to look specifically at what's being proposed. And I think in a case where it's exceeding square footage and, say, the reason it was exceeding that square footage is because it was providing an additional bedroom or
an additional
bathroom.
But demand's not based on bedrooms for the residential setting.
It's also not based on square footage.
I know. That's why we have this trigger to allow a 50% addition before you have to bring the parking up to code.
Right. My point is that there are other cases where parking is specifically based on square footage for all commercial uses,
yeah,
for example. And those are consistent with when the city grants modifications. Those modifications remain consistent with the municipal code, and they meet the demand. And in this case, we've got something that isn't even related to square footage and does continue to meet demand. So
it doesn't meet demand.
I mean, it doesn't increase the demand.
Right.
So I think it's a case-by-case basis, and it's in the city's discretion looking at the specific proposal to determine whether it's inconsistent or not, and that increase that was for a new bedroom or something that, you know, foreseeably could increase the intensity of use might be inconsistent. And a case like this that does not do that is potentially consistent, and that's up to the city to exercise its discretion about that.
Okay, great. Thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on 246 San Clemente? If I could say the word. No, okay. Like I said, I did receive the two letters, and you gave me this third one. Have we received any phone calls? No? And I would like to acknowledge that they all are all in support of the project. So I'll close the public hearing. Like I said, I went to the site and looked around there, and the neighborhood is full of one-car garages, so this is going to come up a lot And they're under the same requirements as this particular site, that they're limited to the 50%, and then they need to get the modification. And I agree that it's not going to affect the demand based on transportation's comments. And even if it was proposing to add the second story at this time with new bedrooms, it wouldn't increase the demand. It's still two units. Where I'm really struggling with and agree with staff on is the consistency with the purpose and intent of the zoning ordinance, and that single-family homes per our ordinance is supposed to have two spaces, and depending on what the layout is or where they are, it could be two, one covered, one uncovered in the back, or two covered. In this instance, it's two covered parking spaces. And I just can't get to the part that it's consistent with the purpose and intent of the zoning ordinance and providing adequate parking on site. Therefore, I agree with staff, and I can't make the required findings. And I appreciate all your arguments. I understand all your arguments. And I just can't get there to make the required findings. So I'll have to make the finding in the staff report and deny the project. My action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days. And if you file that appeal, come here at 630 Garden Street. Don't go to the city clerk's office, because I don't want to make you guys run around. They also have oversight authority of all my actions, and if the liaison felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same 10-day review period. And if that was to occur, Joanne would contact you. Okay?
Yep.
Thanks. So we'll go to the next item, 1330 Cacique Street. Hi again.
I don't know if you want to start out here on, I'm just going to earmark this page. So that's the one. Just hold it for that. Okay. This property is located at 1330 Cacique Street. The property is zoned CP and is a 7,500 square foot lot. Current development on site consists of a commercial complex. And so it's all actually one building because it is connected, but it appears to be kind of two buildings. And there's a rear portion with a two-story and a front portion with a one-story. So you come in along here. This is the rear portion. The proposed project involves interior and exterior alterations to convert the complex to a mixed-use project by converting 1,250 square feet of the second floor of the rear portion of the building to two residential units, so one-bedroom unit and a studio unit. And alterations to the building include removing existing trellises, window and door changes, new rooftop screening walls, new private patios for the residential uses over the existing rooftop of a breezeway, and I'll point these out later. And site alterations that include a new trash enclosure, covered bicycle storage, revised parking layout, landscape changes, removal of two trees, and removal of an existing driveway gate. The requests before you today are an interior setback modification to allow the conversion of commercial floor area to residential units with exterior changes, new bicycle parking, new rooftop walls, and a private outdoor living space, and the required 10-foot interior setback to the east, and an interior setback mod to allow the conversion of the second story to residential uses, and the required 10-foot interior setback to the one of them is the south and one is the east. So, but I'll point this out more when we get to this additional page. So, this outside of property is adjacent to a so this property is zoned CP, and it has different setbacks based on the use and what's zoned on this side. This is a CP zone. It doesn't require a setback. But these two property lines and this site plan will continue on the next page are both adjacent to residential zones, and so they require 10-foot interior setbacks. And so the south side of the property requires a setback of 10 feet. The existing building is approximately 1 foot from the interior property line at its closest point. And a portion of one of the units will be located in this setback, as well as the bicycle parking and
downstairs,
and private outdoor living space on the second story. So those items are proposed to encroach into the setback with the change. And a new wall will be constructed also for the private outdoor living space on the second floor. And there's an existing parapet wall, but it's partial. So those are the modifications in the south interior setback. And then the east interior setback at the rear, it's just the conversion of the second floor to habitable space that requires the modifications. No new openings are proposed on that side. You actually go in, and then the residential uses start back, and this is a hallway. So that's why there's not a lot of changes there. So I wanted to point out a few things about the modifications, and that is that the zoning requirement for residential uses is to provide a private outdoor living space, and the methods being used to provide the space, in this case, is method A, which requires an open space of 10%, which is being met at the property, and it's providing private outdoor living space for each unit. So the units, as proposed, meet that requirement, but they encroach this private outdoor living space into the setback. And the outdoor living space is larger than what is required to be provided. So staff is recommending support of the proposed changes in the setback, except for the proposed outdoor living space, because the proposed outdoor living space we feel is inconsistent with the zoning ordinance, as it's anticipated to adversely impact the adjacent property owners, and it's not really needed to meet the ordinance requirements, as it appears that it could be met. So that's why staff doesn't support that portion of the modification, but we do support the other elements that are being requested, because they're not anticipated to adversely impact the adjacent neighbors. And the breezeway on the first floor for where the bicycle parking will be located and exists now. And so, and there is a door of the same size that's proposed to be changed here, but there was an existing door, and it's comes through, and it's open on the other side. I don't know if this shows
parking.
It. Yeah. So, and staff also supports the interior setback of the rear, because there's no new openings, no new square footage is added to this project, and it's not anticipated to adversely impact the adjacent neighbors. So we wanted to mention that the property is non-conforming to parking, with three existing parking spaces uncovered. And the proposal includes the reconfiguration of the parking layout, but the number of spaces will remain the same. And because no new floor area is proposed, the change of use does not require additional parking, and it can remain at three spaces, provided the building is not demolished. So staff has included conditions that will receive a report from a structural engineer and a preservation or conservation phasing plan at the time of building submittal, to confirm that the building won't be demolished in order to accomplish this, and so that the parking will meet the city's requirements. Transportation staff has reviewed the parking and have stated that the non-conforming parking backs out onto the street, and code-compliant landscaping is not provided, but that a design waiver of the parking design is supportable. And also, transportation acknowledges that bicycle parking is not actually required for this project, but they strongly encourage the applicant to provide it. And so the applicant has provided it, and transportation staff has requested that the applicant look at more accessible bicycle parking. They recommend two bike parking lockers that are ground mounted. And therefore, staff has included conditions in the report to address transportation's comments and concerns. Staff would like the proposal approved and supported, except for the private outdoor living space that encroaches into the south interior setback, subject to the conditions and findings outlined in the staff report.
So. Okay, do you know what the approved use is for this area?
It was just an open breezeway.
Okay.
So and there, it had, you know...
there's nothing in it now.
Perhaps.
The site.
It had a FAU unit sitting on the ground.
Okay. I thought it'd give you maybe some photos that showed that interior. It's a better view of, that's what it looks like today, so they're...
Okay, great,
obviously you can go in there and do things because it was...
And that was just a gate at the end, not a door.
Yeah.
Okay, great, thank you. You like? I know you already stated it. Can you state your name?
My name is Diana Kelly. I'm representing Becker Studios.
Okay, would you like to add anything else?
I want it to be known that we first tried the outdoor living space right here outside of the setback with the access this way, and then it was walled off. ABR hated it, so I had to redesign it. And it's everybody feels it's nicer the way it's drawn now. We certainly, it looks like we could take out the 29 square feet to get the recommended to make it equal to the other one, perhaps by doing some... wall right there, maybe more of a screen perhaps, or some like even a landscape screen if you want more of a buffer then to that residence on the other side of the property line, if that's the issue. But we're required to have that outdoor living space. I've made it just nice and clean like that to get past the door, and to have it it has to be connected directly.
So I tried
making a path, and I had it over here knowing the ordinance, and ABR hated it. So I'm caught between in the process now, it seems. But this seems like the cleanest design. And what I'm saying is this is only a 3-foot high parapet. I'd have to add 6 inches anyway for guardrail protection. So I was going to do a metal rail on top of that parapet, you know, to meet our guardrail standard. So as I'm saying, this is the studio and this is the one bedroom, so this area here could be smaller than what it is. And I just know that for their own sake, these people would put up landscaping to buffer their view of that neighbor. So they have their own privacy on our project. So to benefit both properties, we could put a buffer of, you know, some sort of physical screen then that has to be there if it's more privacy. I mean, these are like yoga people. They're very quiet. These who will be here now, our client.
Well, in the future,
yeah. So in the future, you can't tell, right? But
Can I ask a question regarding the design board? So in their comments, it didn't only go once? It only shows once on here. Did you attend the hearing or were you able? Oh, that's fine. Because what it says here, so has the ABR reviewed this open yard area?
Only concept, and then we had to come here, and then we will go back.
Okay, so yeah. The ABR has not reviewed this layout here.
No, but that is what they told me to do.
It just says here, restudy the configuration of the roof decks. And when I look at the Good Neighbor guidelines, it's inconsistent with the Good Neighbor guidelines, so that's why I'm wondering if the design board looked at it. So that's the answer to the question. They didn't look at this layout. Okay.
Not yet.
Okay. And I know what the requirements are. It's in the staff report, too. Do you have anything else you want to add?
We have bike parking for residents downstairs, and then bike parking will be in this garage that you'll see on this plan all along this wall, as noted on the site plan. Karen Gumtow has looked at our trash, so we've enlarged that and met her needs, recommendations. This used to be all fully a commercial radio station, so... it's going to be a lot less use on the land, too.
Okay.
And no exterior work here to this residential building, as Joanne said, so it's all internal, and this setback isn't even noticed by anybody. And that is all.
Yeah, I think the neighbors on the east side, they're not going to notice any difference between it.
Nicer looking building.
Yeah.
Everything will be enhanced.
Okay, great. Thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing. And there's no one in the audience, and there's no public comment attached to my staff report. Have we received any letters or calls?
Let me just see that file. I just want to relook at it. I haven't received any calls. I'm just double checking to see.
There was
no. I don't have any correspondence.
Okay, so I'll close the public hearing. I did go to the site, and thank you for making it accessible to me. I know it's all chained off because it's empty.
Yeah,
it's empty right now. So I looked. One question I had, I understand the non-conforming parking situation. You get credit for what's there in that. And I just want to confirm again in the hearing, Joanne, that transportation look, I guess it's an existing situation in terms of backing out. It's...
Yeah, that's it's what all, they said. They could support a waiver
on
the design.
Yeah, just walking down, just trying to imagine a car trying to maneuver out, but it's an existing situation and you're not changing anything. And if anything, maybe it's getting less intense use because you're going to residential versus office.
Exactly.
So, that's just my first thought when I walked down there thinking, oh, wow, that's going to be
it
difficult.
It can be done, but it's tricky.
Yeah, and you can't.
And that's pretty steep right here.
Mm-hmm. You
as
can't
you've noticed
do a
where the gate
turnaround.
Is. Yeah. Right. I mean, I could if you do it a couple of times. So, but if others are there.
Yeah, it's going to be hard. But it's existing.
I really think they're going to have a lot of bicycles for these current people, but I know what you mean for later on.
Mm-hmm.
But we're staying consistent with what's there now.
Okay, so I'll address these in regards to the different modifications. So in regards to the, and I'm just going to focus on the second floor because that's what you need the mods for. In regards to the conversion of the interior of the building to residential use from commercial uses within the setback, it is an appropriate improvement on the lot. There's no openings. There's no new openings. It's all interior. And through the building permit phase, it's going to be verified that those walls can remain. But it, based on these plans, I see it's all interior. Well,
yes.
There's just some new window or these
yes,
windows
doors,
or changes.
Doors with balconies.
It's not.
We've had it structurally analyzed.
Okay.
So we are keeping our walls, as you stated, is a requirement. So we're working with an engineer already.
Okay, so in regards to the modifications that involve the conversion of the use itself, I can find appropriate. I can't make the findings for this outdoor living space to be in that area. When you look at the aerial here, this is the subject building here down along. And so this is the existing roof area. There's mechanical equipment and stuff.
Right.
Here's the neighbor's residence, and this is their open area. So it's focused right on there. And I know they're going to want to do their privacy, but still it's in direct conflict with the good neighbor policies. And I don't see how even this wall can be moved over and a door similar to this be put in and the area be outside of the setback. I think there is other options to provide it. That wouldn't impact the neighbor so much. And so I couldn't make the finding regarding the second floor deck.
Being in that setback at all.
Yeah.
Not even putting up a barrier.
You know,
to meet the square footage requirement.
It will meet the square footage requirement because your square footage requirement for a second floor or higher for the studio is 60 square feet. So that's an ordinance requirement, just 60 square feet with a minimum dimension of 6 feet on the second floor. And then for your unit over here, the one bedroom, it's actually just 72 square feet, again, a minimum dimension of 6 feet. So the requirement's significantly less, and I think by reconfiguring it, you can meet the ordinance requirements and still provide a nice area for the residents. So I can't approve that portion of the modification. It just has too much potential to cause a significant impact to the
okay.
the neighbors.
So we'll redo that.
Yeah.
What happens now, then? I have to come back for another modification
hearing?
Nope,
I can...
You can do it with the stipulation, and then it gets looked
so
at.
So what the conditions are here, what the staff was proposing, because in their recommendation, they have the findings all set out to approve everything except for this portion of the project.
Okay.
So the conditions of approval, if you look at them, it says, the number 5, it says the project shall be redesigned to relocate the required private outdoor living space outside of the required setbacks.
Okay.
So then you can do that, and you can work with the design board to get an appropriate layout that
acceptable.
They're comfortable with, that the owners are comfortable with. So
okay.
Note that having that condition in there allows you to not have to come back to me.
Great. Okay. Only because it takes a while.
I understand. The other part, actually, of the conversion request is I don't see the necessity of this door. I know it's a gate now, but there's like 6 inches between the property. So I would condition it that this just be a solid wall. It can you can still do bicycle storage, or if you want to switch it around, or it's a fine. It's okay with me to have this be usable space, but just this door so close to the property line, I don't see the necessity for it, and it just will provide. It'll have less.
Yeah, and then the neighbor puts everything up against the building, so it's not like it's being maintained by this property.
Yeah, so. So that removed the door. And then I just wanted to clarify or add just one sentence to the first condition. It says, a design standard waiver of the landscaping for the parking shall be obtained subject to review and approval by the Public Works Department. I know they've indicated support of it, but if some reason they can't approve it, then I just want to put a condition that if the waiver is not granted, the project shall be revised to comply with the standard. Okay. Just that it's a given. It's going to have to be, but just so that it's clear, so someone understands that that it would need to comply. And then the site visibility. I don't remember in your presentation if you talked about the site visibility triangle.
It's on the plan, sorry.
Yeah.
And
there's chain link. Yeah, so what...
There's chain link here from the neighbor. Mm-hmm. She's got this and a gate here.
Yeah, so what the condition says is a note shall be included on the site plans that fences, walls, and hedges located within the site visibility triangle by the driveway shall not exceed 3.5 feet in height except for the, and I'm going to put existing 6-foot chain link fence just so that it's subject to review and approval by the Public Works Department. And then I just want to make it clear again that any landscaping behind the existing chain link fence shall also comply with the site visibility triangle. So that any landscape...
It's your driveway, yeah.
Yeah, so...
Oh, here, right.
So
here,
it'd be on your property.
In that planter. Mm-hmm.
So you
do have a landscape architect, Arcadia, working with us. So we've submitted plans to ABR. They've looked at it, too.
Okay, so yeah. So
we're
that's
working
just,
with them, and we'll make sure those are under 42 inches top of plant.
Yeah, whatever transportation is based on where the sidewalk is. So you really only have control of this side, so it wouldn't pertain to...
Luckily, that's just her driveway.
Yeah.
So you've seen it yourself, mm-hmm. and the black will come down. Mm-hmm. That little cloth that they mm-hmm. put on the chain link will come off that. That's just for demo.
Okay, so with
but
those...
But it's open visible through the chain link. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay, so then with the... revisions to conditions 1 and 2, and then the new one regarding the door for the bicycle.
Okay, close it off.
Yeah, I can make the findings in the staff report and approve the project. Again, I'm just going to add in the number 4 that it says it's not anticipated to adversely impact the adjacent neighbor's property and put and privacy. Just so clear why.
So we're going to shrink the square footage to the required, pull it out of mm-hmm. there. Because I don't think, I mean, I wish we could put it over there and give everybody a nicer patio, but... Mm-hmm.
Just the constraints of the site and the development around.
I'd rather do that to give them a bigger outdoor space mm-hmm. and use it more out of the setback.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I'll talk to the client and the boss about that.
Okay, all right. So with those changes, I'll approve the project. My action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days, and they also have oversight authority of all my actions, and if they felt it warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same 10-day review period, and if either of those would occur, Joanne would contact you.
Great.
Okay?
Thank you very much.
Great, sure. All right. I adjourn the meeting.
Thank you. There you go.